Mina, konbanwa, Jesus Freakin' Gamer here. First things first, please forgive me. I did not release this 30-minute message on Sunday like I should have, nor did I release a video game footage. There were reasons, but essentially it was my fault. I could have done it if I had planned things better. I didn't plan things better, so it is my mistake, and it is me failing once again. Like I said earlier on this week, I will fail you. I guarantee it. So I apologize for that first and foremost. I'll also issue forth this apology on the shorter message, which will follow up this message here. It'll kind of be a continuation, sort of kind of based on what I read in Nehemiah today, but for now, the 30-minute message. And the 30-minute message is going to be about the wrath of God. Now, this isn't something that I go out of my way to proclaim and talk about a whole lot. I don't necessarily try to, you know, browbeat any of my subscribers. I also don't try to do it in real life. I don't really find it the best way to evangelize to say, "You're gonna burn in hell! You need to repent now!" That's kind of a stereo, or maybe a slam my hand on something nearby for emphasis. You think about the old-timey preachers, the hellstone, fire, and brimstone people, and you kind of think about those kind of impressions, the slamming of the fist on something, the pointing of the finger, the yelling real loud, and things like that. And I generally try not to do that. Not because hell isn't real, not because the wrath of God isn't real, but because generally you say something like that and people's defenses go right up. They don't want to listen to you. I will admit, in my experience, not a whole lot of people are interested in listening to begin with, or in my case, a lot of people claim to already be Christians, go to church, and it's more of them not living for God and possibly not being saved because, like, they believe in God, but they're not really living for Him. So I doubt they've actually put their faith. I doubt they've actually put their faith in Christ. That's kind of off topic, but. So yeah, I try my best when I approach people, whether they listen to me or not. And again, it feels like a whole lot of people don't really listen to me a whole lot, and all I can say is, oh well, I am trying. I do try to get the word out. So if people don't listen to me, if I'm doing something wrong, hopefully I'll learn what it is. And if I'm doing something right, then I can only assume that it's something, some future thing down the road that's going to happen. Someone's going to repent. Someone's going to come to Christ. And I simply don't have the chance to see it at the moment. And I have to accept that and say that's fine. I generally don't come about it from a wrath perspective, though, because I don't know. I have no problem telling people that, you know, they've committed sin. They've done things wrong. They're going to meet their maker when they die, you know. And when you die and God asks you if you deserve to go into His heaven, what are you going to say? I have no problem approaching it from that perspective, but just immediately going up to someone and saying, you're going to hell, it sounds judgmental in a very bad way. I have no problem saying that something is a sin and something is wrong, or that, you know, I'm a sinner, you're a sinner. I think it's pretty much accepted that everyone is a sinner. Most people understand, at least when I've talked to them, the Christian perspective of, yeah, we're all sinners, yeah, we all need God, yeah, we all need forgiveness. And that kind of general mentality. But going up to someone and just saying, hey, you're going to burn in hell. Yes, if someone doesn't know Jesus, their eventual destination will be hell and the wrath of God is on them. But I want to show them the love of God and show them why, or I should say how they can get away from that wrath, how they are loved by God, how He doesn't want to pour out His wrath on them, and how Jesus loved them enough to die on the cross for them and forgive them for their sins. That is my preferred approach. I'd much rather go up to someone, you know, say, hey, how's it going? How's your day going? My name's Brandon. It's good to meet you. You know, can I interest you? Can I talk to you about some really good news? There's a God, Jesus, who changed my life. I'd much rather do it from that perspective. If someone asks me about hell, I will point blank and tell them, if you're not a believer in Jesus Christ, yes, hell exists, and without belief in Him, yes, you will go there. I don't mince my words when it comes to that, but it's not the general way that I come to someone. However, the wrath of God is an important topic, and it is something that it's on the minds of some people pretty heavily. And I want to address that topic. And the reason I'm addressing that topic today is because of something very specific that happened to me recently. I've said it before, I'll say it again, I'm one of those crazy Christians who believes that God speaks to him and God personally communicates with me, not just in the Bible, not just through prayer and through Bible reading and through circumstances, but I believe that sometimes some of the thoughts that come to my mind are not my thoughts. Those are actually God's words coming to me, instructing me how to live my life. Someone needs a particular ministry. I need to repent of a specific sin. I need to do something specific with my life. And I've mentioned in several videos in the past, I've mentioned some specific sins in the past, and I've mentioned some recurring sins of my life. I won't go into specific details about this particular sin that I was about. You guys know that I'm a sinner. It'll come out later on in today's message. We've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. It's Romans 3:23. That's actually somewhere near the bottom of my notes on screen here. So there's a heads up right there. I am also still a sinner. All Christians that are born again right now, we still have a sin nature. We still fall into sin. And even though I didn't include this in my notes in the book of Ecclesiastes, it says that it is impossible for a righteous man not to sin. Google is your friend. You can make that your homework here. There will be plenty of scriptures talked about throughout this message that I will give book, chapter, and verse for. So that I'll give you that one little bit of homework right there. But during this particular sin that I needed to repent of, a sin that I had committed, God got angry with me. I think it's only the second time to my knowledge where I'm in the middle of, you know, said sin, or it's the aftermath of said sin, something like that. And I literally hear a voice in my mind saying, "Sit down." Can I tell you, when God yells at you, it's scary? Can I just put that out there? And he sat me down and he gave me a very stern talking to. And it felt just like a father sitting a child down, a young child. And I'm not young anymore. I'm 36 years old. Nothing young about me anymore. But he sat me down like a little child and he read me the riot act, so to speak. He was mad at this particular sin of mine. Basically, you know, it's time to repent. It's time to stop. You know why you're doing this, so put an end to it now. Complete with a promise that judgment will hit me at this point. That's also very scary. The judgment of God isn't something that I look at lightly or take lightly. So when God says judgment is coming, I'm quite frankly terrified. So that was a scary, scary encounter. I was like, focus, Brandon. There are so many things I could go off on there. I'm going to try to stick to the notes here because the 30 minutes goes by so quick and I end up blabbing. I've already blabbed a little bit here, but that was the setup for this message. It was a reminder to me that God's anger is very real. And a lot of, especially in American churches, they talk about the love of God and they talk about the beauty of God and the goodness of God. And when I talk to someone that I don't know, I will tell them, you know, again, my preferred approach of evangelism is, you know, I love you. God loves you. God has a plan for your life. God has wonderful things in store for you. And I try not to bring up the hellfire, brimstone, smoke, eternal suffering thing forever right off the bat. That's not my preferred approach. There comes a point in conversation where if it comes up, I'll talk about it. If I get to know the person well enough, I very well will tell them, hey, you don't know Jesus. Hell's a real thing. It's something you need to be concerned about. I'm very, very convinced of it as a Christian that the Bible isn't speaking of hell in a metaphoric manner. And that is ultimately a sign of God's wrath. God's anger. It's the ultimate form of God's anger poured out on man. It's something that Jesus took care of for me since I asked him to forgive me with the blood he shed on the cross for me. So I don't have to worry about hellfire as long as I continue to walk with him throughout my life. As long as I have faith in him and I don't reject him and go off after some other god, or, you know, reject all gods and become an atheist or an agnostic, I don't have to worry about hell. But that doesn't mean God isn't angry about some of the sins, especially the recurring ones, in my life. It's a very real thing, and I wanted to talk about that today with that very real, to me, very personal experience that I had. So I'm going to kick this off with a verse and an explanation. It's going to be Romans chapter 1, verse 18. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. Now, some of you may say to me, well, Brandon, you know, regardless of whether I think you're, you know, crazy or not, whether or not I'm a Christian or not, you're proudly proclaiming your righteous truth right now. You're proclaiming the way of Jesus and you're proclaiming the word of God. You're trying to be a preacher and a holy man. How does this verse apply to you at all? The wrath of God's revealed from heaven against ungodliness and unrighteousness, who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. And at this point, here's the clarification. Some people will make a distinction between the wrath of God and the judgment of God. I honestly, up to this message and up to me preparing for this message, I haven't thought too much about the difference between the two, so I don't really have an answer for you. I apologize for that. It's something I probably will seek out. Maybe not immediately, because there are other things I'm interested in researching at the moment, but it's probably something someday that will come back to my head. And at that point, I will look it up. But right now, I simply don't have an answer. As far as the judgment of God, when I think of the judgment of God, yes, there are judgments that hit us in this life. There's wrath that hits us in this life. So I spoke about the wrath of God being poured out from heaven now. And here is a verse speaking of the judgment that is to come. It is Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27. And as it is appointed for men to die once, but after this, the judgment. Again, a fairly popular doctrine, even most non-Christians know of it, that at some point after we die, people can argue, you know, if it's like at the end of the world, as soon as you die, some weird time differentiation thingamadoohick or whatever. At some point after you die, you will stand before your Maker, and you will be judged. Jesus talks about every word, action, and thought will be judged. Jesus also talks about how the Father has appointed all judgment to the Son. So you will specifically stand before Jesus when you die. Yes, Jesus is God, and yes, when you stand before your God, your Maker, you're going to see the scars at His brow. You're going to see the nail prints in His hands. And depending on whether or not He's wearing sandals or any kind of shoes, you'll see the holes in His feet as well. And He may even show you the hole in His side. So, it's a scary, scary thought to stand before Him and Him not be your God. Because at that point, it's only wrath. Your judgment will not end well. And I'm going to cover that at the end of this message as well, so I won't belabor the point right now. It's just, I thought about that, and I'm like, oh my gosh, just God being angry at me was scary enough. Standing before Him without any reconciliation or any kind of, you know, possible repentance is absolutely terrifying to me. But the wrath of God and the judgment of God, so we have the wrath and the judgment that is to come, and we have wrath and judgment right here and now on earth. We have an eternal wrath and judgment. We have temporary or temporal wrath and judgment here on earth. And I'm going to be covering, I basically just covered the eternal side of it, talking about hell and judgment before God and needing Him to save you, which I will talk about a little bit more at the altar call, even though there's not a physical altar, the altar call at the end of this message. I would now like to go over some of the wrath and judgment of God mentioned in Scripture. Now, I will not be making a clear-cut distinction between the two. I may use both terms interchangeably. I will speak of when a judgment like or a flowing of wrath comes with a promise, a chance to repent, and when it does not, it's simply, you know, this wrath is unto destruction. This is a permanent, destructive, unrepentant judgment or wrath. So I will not be distinguishing between the two. I'll use both words probably interchangeably throughout this message because I have never, again, up until this point, I've never really thought about the difference between the two. God's judgment is there to line us up with Him, but if that judgment doesn't become a tool to bring us closer to Him, that judgment will simply result in our destruction. So with that, let's go all the way back to the very beginning, and that's going to be Genesis chapter 3, starting at verse 6. This is where Adam and Eve ate of the tree of knowledge of good and evil and are kicked out of the garden. And so immediately, God's wrath, God's judgment has to hit because they have sinned. So verse 6, so when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree desirable to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. She also gave to her husband with her, and he ate. Jumping down to verses 8 and 9, and they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. Then the Lord God called to Adam and said to him, "Where are you?" I talked about God's omniscience last week, which basically means he knows everything. He is all-knowing. So I do want to take just a second to say, when the all-knowing God asks you a question, it's not because he doesn't know the answer. It's because you need to think firmly, clearly, and deliberately on that question. When he asks you a question, it's for your sake, not for his. And of course, we know that they had to be kicked out of the Garden of Eden because they had sinned. So I'm going to jump down to verse 14 and the judgment that was pronounced. So the Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, you are cursed more than all cattle and more than every beast of the field. On your belly you shall go, and you shall eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel." There, he does go on to speak forth a judgment to the woman and to Adam as well, to Adam and Eve. And that isn't, we know that they were kicked out of the garden. You can, I'll say, and if you don't believe me, feel free to read the beginning of verse 24. "So he drove out the man, and he placed cherubim at the east of the Garden of Eden, and a flaming sword which turned every way to guard the way to the tree of life." And yes, when he drove out the man, he drove out the woman as well. Don't let that one particular word mess around with you. You go down to chapter 4, Eve is with Adam. So it stands to conclusion that neither one of them were allowed in the garden back at that point, as they had both sinned. So there was punishment. There was an immediate judgment. Now this particular judgment came with a promise. You go back up to verse 15.
Oh, please excuse me.
"He shall, between your seed and her seed, he shall bruise your head and you shall bruise his heel." The woman's seed spoken of there was Christ, God coming in the flesh. "He'll bruise the serpent's head, a fatal wound, and you shall bruise his heel." It hurts, but ultimately will not be fatal. God, Jesus' body was killed. He rose again 3 days later. Jesus, it hurt. But ultimately, Jesus was fine and dandy, and he conquered Satan, death, and hell at that time. So there was immediate judgment, but there was a promise. They were never allowed back in the garden, but they weren't completely cut off from God's presence forever. And then there is the flood, Genesis chapter 6, verses 5 through 8. "Then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And the Lord was sorry that he had made man on the earth, and he was grieved in his heart." I look at that and I just think to myself, how bad, like, people want to talk about how bad America is and how America has sinned. Personally, I do not believe that America is beyond hope. I don't believe that America is past the point of where God's judgment is definitely going to rain down, America's going to be destroyed. I think America still has hope. I know I'm an American, I still follow God. I know several other people that are with me. They love God, and they're still trying to serve God. And I know my pastor, he knows other pastors in other churches where those people try to love God, and those people try to serve God. Heck, there's even political movements in America, love them or hate them, who try to ensure that Christian morality and laws get passed in our Congress and House. And all I can say to that is it is absolutely wonderful. I'm glad those things exist in the United States. They're not perfect. Far from it. But there are Christians who care in this nation and that want to live for God and that love Him. And I do not believe, and I personally believe also that God has told me that America, it's not America's like final hour yet. It's not like there's going to be wrath without measure unto destruction. There's going to be judgment, but there's not going to be wrath unto destruction in this nation. America still has hope. I can think of several other nations that would qualify based on just sins and various beliefs that would qualify for the judgment of God much quicker than America. So I just want to put that out there. So what it would take for God to want to wipe out all of mankind, it's hard for me to begin to imagine the level of sin and widespread violence that was on the earth. And actually, the New Testament, when it talks about the times of Noah, it mentions the word violence specifically, so I wasn't just kind of pulling that out of thin air. More homework if you care to look it up. And then to continue reading here, so he was grieved in his heart. So the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, creeping thing and birds of the air, for I am sorry that I have made them. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. So even with all of this wrath and all of this anger, to the point where the Lord was grieved in his heart, there was still a promise. Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Mankind would not be wiped out completely, but Noah, his wife, his sons, and their wives would board an ark with various animals on the world. That was horrible English, but you know what I mean. And thus, the world would continue on after that very harsh judgment on sin. That wrath was poured out on mankind, but there was a promise there, and there was a continuation and an extension of grace there through Noah to the human race. And I'm like, okay, how much time do I have left? I knew that this time was going to fly by very, very quickly. Just to make some New Testament tie-ins, because a lot of people, I thought this when I started the message, and a lot of people are thinking right now, yeah, Brandon, you want wrath, you want anger, you want an angry God? Look throughout the entire Old Testament. Look at,
excuse me,
doggone it. Maybe I shouldn't do these late at night, but this is the only time I find to do them. I apologize. You want to find an angry God? Look at what God did to the nations and to his own people, Israel, all throughout the Old Testament. You can find anger and wrath and judgment and death, etc., 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 all throughout the Old Testament. This is not just an Old Testament thing. I would like you to keep in mind that a burning eternal hell, well, the eternal part is mentioned in the Old Testament once, but the afterlife isn't specifically mentioned very often. The only thing that's really talked about is where Job talks about he'll see God in the flesh, and then Daniel talks about those who are righteous will shine forever, and those who are wicked, they will face everlasting shame. There's not too much more said about the afterlife in the Old Testament. We simply know that there will be one, and apparently there will be a resurrection if we see God in the flesh, based on what Job said. But it's the New Testament where we learn about hell, an eternal place of suffering and torment forever and ever. Yeah, that was a very redundant thing to say, but I did it for emphasis. Hell is eternal. The suffering is forever. It never stops. And then, and Jesus, God in the flesh, he's the one that talks about hell so much. Paul actually doesn't mention hell explicitly in any of his epistles. Did you know that? You want to hear a lot about hell? Look at Jesus. Hear his words. He talks about hell more than anyone else in the New Testament. And when we don't have the Old Testament specifying what eternity awaits those who are with God and without God, you find out from Jesus that for the saved, it's wonderful, and for the unsaved, it is absolutely terrifying. So the Old Testament talks about God's wrath and judgment. The New Testament brings us hell. And also, just to give you something on the more temporal side, which to me is nowhere near as terrifying as an eternal hell, but just to show that God's got teeth for this life and not just the life to come, I'd like to point out first off in Acts, well, actually, let me back up to Luke chapter 23, verse 6 first, because this kind of leads into the thing in Acts. Herod Antipas, the one who succeeded Herod the Great in ruling over Judah and Jerusalem at the time of Jesus' life, and the one who put John the Baptist to death. You go to Luke 23, We're going to start at verse 6. When Pilate heard of Galilee, he asked if the man were a Galilean. And as soon as he knew that he belonged to Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who was also in Jerusalem at that time. Now when Herod saw Jesus, he was exceedingly glad, for he had desired for a long time to see him, because he had heard many things about him, and he hoped to see some miracle done by him. Then he questioned him with many words, but he answered him nothing. Jesus usually had a response or a retort of some kind. He usually didn't just ignore people. In fact, this is the only time in all four Gospels where Jesus just outright ignores someone who is addressing him. He answered him nothing. Can I tell you, when the God of the universe isn't talking to you, you're in the very worst position you could possibly be in. If God's ignoring you, that's like, I mean, what's the worst thing that a person can do? The worst thing a person can do isn't to taunt you, to pick on you, to bully you. The worst thing a person can do is to ignore you. Because at that point, your existence isn't even registered by them, or they're purposefully trying to put your existence away from their mind. And if God wants to put your existence out of his mind, there's obviously only one place for you to go. And just to spell it out, that's hell. Herod was completely damned from that point. If not from before that, from that point on. He was as good as finished. So if you go forward to Acts chapter 12, verse 21. So on a set day, this is after Jesus rose from the dead and the apostles are already, you know, winning souls, filled with the Holy Spirit, Pentecost, all that good stuff. So on a set day, Herod, arrayed in royal apparel, sat on his throne and gave an oration to them. To them, just people. You want to find out who those people are, go up a few verses above. Not really important to my particular point. And the people kept shouting the voice of a god and not of a man. Then immediately an angel of the Lord struck him because he did not give glory to God. And he was eaten by worms and died. I don't know exactly what that looks like. I don't think I want to know. That is foul and disgusting. That is just plain gross. And that was Herod's end. That's how he met his end. Wrath in this life, and most definitely wrath in the life to come. Jesus isn't even going to talk to you. There was more hope for the Pharisees than there was for Herod. At least he told the Pharisees that hell was coming towards him. He spoke nothing to Herod. And again, that's just a thought that really, kind of like when God was angry, that was a bit scary. The thought of hell is terrifying. The thought of God ignoring me and saying nothing to me, That is fear without measure, because that's a fear with no hope. If you go on, I don't really have the time for this. If you go to Acts chapter 5, verses 1 through 11, you can read the story of Ananias and Sapphira. They were Christians. They were believers. And I won't necessarily say that they went to hell for their sin, but they lied about what they gave to the church. And if you want some context as to what this whole giving of the church thing is, it's usually not mentioned in reference to their story. That is going to be in Acts chapter 4, verses 32 through 37. You can find out a little bit about the communal living of the church and how people were giving their money to the apostles. Ananias and Sapphira, they gave money to the apostles, but they held some back. I'm guessing that they were lying about how much they gave, or about giving it all as opposed to giving some of it. And the Holy Spirit struck them dead when Peter confronted them with their sin. Killed them. Boom, right there. Now, since they were Christians, I will not say that they just immediately went to hell and that this sin was unforgivable. I will not say that. Christians, there is a great grace and a great mercy and a great love that God has for people that he created in his image and likeness. And he doesn't want anyone to go to hell. But that doesn't mean judgment won't fall. I have no idea what judgment's going to await me for the sins that I've committed that God said was going to fall. I have no idea what stupidities and sins that I'm going to commit in the future, which will necessitate further acts of judgment on God's part to make me fully repent and fully come back to him. I don't know. I do know that judgment to a believer, there's a good end to that. I get closer to God, I see who he is, I see how right he is, and then I change my ways. And God also works in my heart and in my soul and in my mind to help change me as well. So judgment for a believer, there's hope there. Ananias and Sapphira, what I think happened, and this is just my opinion, But I'm welcome to my opinion. What I think happened was they were killed. So they stood before God in judgment. And Jesus basically said, what's wrong with you? Why would you lie to an all-knowing God? That's kind of stupid, wasn't it? They got a good chewing out. And then he said, okay, I've rebuked you, but you accepted me as your Lord and Savior. And you're sorry for what you've done. You've thoroughly seen how wrong you were. So, you've, and a judgment, it talks about in, I want to say, 1 Corinthians 3, talks about the judgment where the gold, silver, and precious stones of our good works will be polished and refined at the judgment, but all of our selfish, sinful works, wood, hay, and stubble will be burned up. So I imagine that at that point, Jesus said, okay, you've been judged for your sin. You paid with your life for that particular last sin, which was really dumb, but come on in. I think that it's my opinion. Again, I'm welcome to it. I think since they were believers, I think there was grace there. I think there was mercy and forgiveness there when they stood before Jesus at the judgment seat. Love and forgiveness don't stop in this life, folks. It's that love and forgiveness which was going to escort us into the life to come. And that's where I want to invite you right now to step out of the wrath of God and step under the umbrella of grace that Jesus Christ is holding. I'm just imagining like lava and fire falling from the sky. And Jesus is holding this giant umbrella, welcoming as many as want to get out of that mess under the umbrella that he built himself, that he himself propped up. And he propped it up by coming to this world, dying on the cross for us, shedding his blood for the remission or forgiveness of our sins, and then he rose up again the third day, guaranteeing eternal life to anyone and everyone who will come to him. And I want to invite you to get out of the wrath of God. I don't care what you're involved in. I don't care what sin you've committed. I don't care how bad that sin is. I don't care if you're in the middle of some horrible crisis, which may be judgment or wrath for that sin right now. Forgiveness is available to you. If you're alive and you're hearing this, and you're in your heart, you want to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you can right now. And I'm asking you, pleading with you. Heck, I'll even command you, come to Christ now. Stop waiting. Stop sinning. Stop being stupid and come to Christ right now. Now, I don't care if I offended some of you. Some of you needed to hear that. You know you're being dumb. You know you need to stop the mess you're doing. So stop it. Stop it now. Come to Christ right now. Tell him you believe that he died for you. Tell him you believe he rose again. Tell him you want him to be your God and your Savior. And if you want a model prayer to follow, pray this prayer after me. Say, Lord Jesus, I admit I'm a sinner, and I need your forgiveness. I believe you died on the cross, shedding your blood, so my sins could be forgiven. And I believe that you rose again 3 days later. And I believe you're alive and you hear this prayer right now. So please, Jesus, forgive my sin, be my God, my Master, and my Savior. And thank you for forgiving me. Amen. Doesn't mean the consequences are erased or completely gone, but it does mean in God's eyes you're completely clean, you're washed in the blood of the Lamb, in the blood of his Son, Jesus, and you're now his son or his daughter, and you are now on your way to eternal life in heaven, even if the consequences for your sin are going to take their toll, even if it means all the way to the extent of losing your life. You can be sure and guaranteed that when you step out of this life and into the next, now you know the God you're going to stand before. And now he is your friend. Now he's your Father. He's your Lord, your Master, and your Savior. And you have all of eternity to rejoice in how good your God is. You sinned. You deserved his wrath. You were born into it. And you needed help. And you accepted the help that your Maker gave to you. And that's what's most important. You're now saved, you're a child of God, and you're on your way to heaven. And for those of you who are not facing death immediately, hopefully more of you than less, for those of you who are about to enter heaven, I'm sorry, depending on the circumstances, I'm sorry it took this much to get your attention. And I'm sorry for whatever suffering you're going through right now. Please rest assured, even though this life may be over for you, something much better is about to kick off if you've accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior. And I'm not just the one saying it. The Word of God, the Bible, is the authority on which I say, you're going to be all right. After you die, things are going to get better. For those of us who are sticking around here for a little bit longer, can I encourage you to read this book? You want to know what else God has to say about specific things that deserve his wrath and specific things that will merit a reward, that will be wonderful things, and that'll, you know, be that gold, silver, and precious stones that will chalk up to good stuff at the judgment. Read this book. Read his word. It'll show you what he thinks on things, what he thinks is right and what's wrong. By the way, if God thinks it, it's not just his opinion. It's absolute reality and truth. So get to reading that as soon as you can. Find a group of believers, usually it's in a church, who you can share your new faith with, who you can share life struggles with, who can pray for you, who you can pray with. You want to be stronger. You want to be sharper in your faith. It's going to come through reading the Bible, finding other people who believe, and also through prayer. And it doesn't have to be anything complicated or, you know, grandiose. Just a simple, God, thank you for the day, or God, this day sucks, please help. Those are valid prayers that God hears and will answer. So be sure to do that a few times a day. Keep your God in mind, because his thoughts for you are more than the grain of sand on the shore, more than the stars in the sky. So be sure to think about him every now and then in return. Guys, thank you very much for watching this video. I love you. May God deliver us all from his wrath into a good judgment where we've been obedient to him. And God bless.